Welcome to the Empowered Wife Podcast, where it's all about fixing your relationship without your man's conscious effort so that you feel desired, taken care of, and special, even if your relationship feels completely hopeless. I'm Laura Doyle, and today I'm sharing insights from The Husband of a Ridiculously Happy Wife, part 4 of 4 of our man panel. My guest, Matthew, is not a student. He's not a book reader. But rather, he's the husband of a new Laura Doyle certified relationship coach, and he generously agreed to be part of our man panel series. Today, I'm going to get his perspective on the changes in his family as a result of his wife using the connection framework and the 6 intimacy skills. He's also going to answer some anonymous questions from students who wanted to hear the husband's perspective. So we're going to get that. Get ready to hear the male perspective on what makes men attracted to their wives and what makes them want to be her hero. The worst relationship advice of the week award is still on hiatus during our special man panel series, but it will be back next week. My guest, Matthew, has had an extraordinary transformation in the last couple of years. He's going to describe what things were like at his house before his wife started studying the 6 intimacy skills along with the connection framework, and what it's like now. He's going to explain why he gives his wife the credit for his 18 months of sobriety and his 80-pound weight loss. And he's going to describe what she did that motivated him to make those changes. Matthew melted me right from the start of the interview when he described how he feels about his wife. And it was humbling to hear his incredible side of the story and his reactions to the changes that his wife made as she was working to become a relationship coach. I learned so much from Matthew. He's one brave, open, and accountable guy. Now, imagine being his wife who invited him on the show on my behalf to be a guest and talk openly about their marriage on a podcast that's been downloaded over 1 million times. Can you imagine the courage that must take? I want to give a big shout out to Matthew's wife for the gift of her husband sharing with us on this podcast. I'm incredibly grateful for your generosity. If you'd like to be my guest on the Empowered Wife podcast and share about how you fixed a struggling relationship using the 6 intimacy skills, I would love to interview you. Just go to lauradoyle.org/podcast-guest to let me know that you are willing to make a big contribution to ending world divorce by telling your relationship story. I look forward to meeting you. That's lauradoyle.org/podcast-guest. My guest Matthew is not a student or a book reader, but rather the husband of a new relationship coach. He generously agreed to be part of our man panel series. And today I'm going to get his perspective on the changes in his family as a result of his wife using the connection framework and the 6 intimacy skills. He's also going to answer anonymous questions from students on the husband's perspective. So get ready to hear the male perspective on what makes men attracted to their wives and wanting to be her hero. Matthew, welcome to the Empowered Wife podcast. Thank you so much for coming on the show.
Absolutely. Thank you. This is exciting.
Cool. Well, let's start with how long have you been married and how many kids do you have?
So we have 2 kids, 2 boys. One just turned 11 about a week ago. The other one is 9 years old.
Okay. And go ahead.
Yeah, we got married in 2007. So whatever that math is.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, we have to do math. All right. So that's a bunch of years. Like
14. We're
14. Okay, 14. Okay.
14 years on December 1st. That's right.
I'm like, no math, please. But all right, yeah, okay. So, and what was your experience like in your marriage before?
Hostile, I think, would probably be the best word to describe it. You know, my wife and I clearly, I mean, now I can tell you that I'm more in love with her than I've ever been. Hmm. But before we got married, as we all know, there's a period of the honeymoon phase, and, you know, we didn't have kids, we didn't have responsibilities. In fact, I don't know what it was like before I had kids, and clearly I don't remember what it was like to be single. But, you know, through courtship, it was fantastic. Obviously, we fell in love, we got married, we decided to move back to Colorado in order to have children. Then once my wife got pregnant, it seemed as though everything changed. And I don't know if everything changed because she was in this nesting phase, but it kind of led, not kind of, it absolutely led to a, and I don't know if she's going to listen to this, but I'm going to be as candid as possible. She went through a control phase that did not end until, you know, a handful of years ago when she met your group. And that control phase was anything from, you know, something as little as you don't know how to feed the baby, or at least properly, so I'm just going to do it. You don't know how to do, XYZ, you can't handle my finances, you can't handle the house, to complete control, to where I just essentially tuned out. So that, you know, that, and it just got progressively worse. Nitpicking, and I think I had built up so much resentment from, in my view, disrespect. And in my view, it was just a, you know, putting me in the corner, which is difficult, I think, for a husband, because once you have kids, you're no longer the primary, you're now the secondary. And to a man, I think, you know, any guy would be lying if they said it didn't hurt. And so that kind of progressively got worse and worse. And then we found ourselves in a position where, candidly, we were at that point of breaking. And it just, the arguments got worse and worse, the nitpicking got worse and worse, and something had to change. And I think that was around the time when Melissa found you.
Wow. Well, yeah, it sounds very painful. It sounds kind of exhausting. I really get the checking out part. It's like, what are your other options if you're not capable enough to do the finances or feed the baby or do any of those things? Then there's really kind of nothing left but to kind of back off. And then you also mentioned the word hostility. So I think that's a natural reaction too, right? Like, this is really uncomfortable. This is tense. I think I'm just gonna kind of recede into the background here. Yeah. It sounds like that's what you did. And what mere mortal person is not going to try to protect themselves in some way when they're feeling like they're, there's also kind of an underlying criticism, right, of sure, not being capable. So how did you first hear about like the books and programs that we have around here?
So my wife had a friend of hers that had been having some marriage issues. And she had passed along a book to my wife that was, I think it was Kill All the all the Marriage Counselors, yeah, which I got to tell you, I fully agree, because we went through the marriage counseling thing and it was an absolute nightmare. Just kind of a sidebar.
Yeah.
Two or three that we went to, it was very clear that the counselors were pitting us against each other. And in fact, we got to one counselor candidly, and she just said, I think it might be time for a divorce. And that's when Melissa and I, my wife and I, were just like, what? That's not what we're looking for. We're here to make amends. We're here to strengthen, not just to have someone tell us it's time for a divorce.
Yeah. Horrible.
Yeah. So anyway, so back to my point of how we heard about it, or she heard about it, and then subsequently I heard about it, was it was passed along to her. She read the book, and I have to tell you, within a matter of weeks, literally within a matter of weeks, our entire lives changed.
Wow, that was quick.
It was quick, but I will tell you, my wife is a very determined person, and when she decides she's going to flip the switch, it is it's pretty remarkable.
It is. And so what were you thinking? I mean, what was your reaction in 2 weeks, you know, a couple of weeks, you're noticing a big change. What was going through your mind at that point?
I thought maybe she was going to divorce me.
Oh, wow.
Because I thought, whoa, wait a minute. Things have changed and they are for the better. And, I heard things like, I trust you. I trust you to make decisions. You are the man of the house. You're our leader. You're our the guidance in our home. And it was just very, not shocking, but it was definitely a new experience because I haven't felt that since our courtship. I think for me, it was, at first it was, I didn't believe it. I thought, yeah. this is not going to last.
This is phony.
This is a, these are mind games. This is a, she's screwing with me somehow. Somehow this is going to backfire on me. That's really how I felt. So my defense mechanisms were still up. I was still very guarded. I was still very angry, very cantankerous with her. And it took me a while to accept the fact that this was the new reality.
Wow. And so how did you start to believe it? Or what happened there?
I think when I started believing it was when she actually started to relinquish control. And it was, she would routinely say to me, you're our leader. In a way. And, the things like the finances, she said, hey, look, I realize I was out of line. I realize I was disrespectful when I hired a financial advisor, when not only are you perfectly capable, but you run a very, very, successful, corporation. And I don't know why I ever doubted you and, things like that. And it just gradually, those were things that gave me confidence in myself because I had been beaten down for so long that I had lost a lot of confidence in myself and as a husband and as a dad. So that's kind of the course of action.
I so appreciate how authentic and candid you're being with us and sharing. This is so valuable to get to hear the husband's perspective, like how it felt before and how it felt as you were transitioning into feeling more respected. Did it scare you at all? I mean, she was asking you to lead or saying that you are the leader. How was that scary?
At first it was, but I had always been very vocal with my wife in saying that it's important to me that I take care of her and that I provide for my family and that I provide for my children. And I think that stems back to my own personal background. That's the way it has been for generations in my family where, call it old fashioned, call it whatever you want, but the husband of the family provides for the family, leads the family, and is the kind of the rock. So for me, it was liberating and it was exhilarating because I finally found my place. Ugh. And, and she allowed that to happen. And I think I give her all the credit in the world because she really took in every single thing that you and your team had put forth and put it into action. And, but yes, to answer your question, it was scary at first, but I found my groove very quickly because that was what I was meant to do.
I love that. That's very inspiring. And I just admire that so much. Like this was always your mission to be the provider and the rock for your family. And it felt like you were finally getting that opportunity in a way that you hadn't been
right
prior to that. Yeah, that's great. So, so how did it impact you that your wife was going through a relationship coach training?
Well, truthfully, at the beginning, I thought, how on earth is she going to be a coach, a count? I'm thinking to myself, there's no way our marriage is a freaking disaster. So how on earth is she going to now teach other people how to be, you know what I'm saying?
I love that. I love, yes. You're thinking, yeah. Okay, little hypocrisy going on around here. Yeah,
that's right. And then when I would tell other friends or my guy friends that I confided in, they looked at me like, Are you kidding me? That can't quite be. There's no possibility that's going to happen. But I can tell you now, in just her interactions with other people that I know she's kind of working with, although she's very guarded. She doesn't let me in on anything, which is fine because candidly, I don't want to know. It's too much drama for me. But I can see a change in her that is just, it's been remarkable. She's become more calm, more patient, more understanding, and she listens now. Before, she never listened to me. But now she's kind of taken that as into the rest of her life, where she listens to me, she listens to our kids, she listens to my parents, which is a tricky thing to do. She listens to everybody and then kind of formulates really, really good thought process and advice.
Wow. So I'm loving this because it seemed impossible. It was like a joke.
Yeah.
When she first started, he thought, this is the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard. This is like somebody obese is going to be a personal trainer or.
Exactly right.
Okay. Okay.
Exactly right.
And now it sounds like you're a believer that.
100%. I will tell you, I never thought. There was a time in our relationship where I thought, this is doomed. This is not going to work. There's no freaking way we're going to make this. I mean, I went so far as to starting to look for apartments. I went so far as to starting to get our finances in order. It on the offset that there was a separation. It was bad. And now, you know, and again, I give her all the credit in the world, because had this not happened, there is no way we'd be married today. No way.
Wow. Amazing.
Yeah. Go ahead and ask your next question.
Oh, you know,
I can go on and on.
You're saying amazing things. I don't want to miss a word of it. So what changes did you experience personally?
Well, I mean, you know, I experienced, a best way to describe it would be kind of a liberation. But I'm not going to lie, I had not been in charge, the man of the house, all of those things in a very long time. So it was stressful because, you know, I think I mentioned, you know, I do own and run a company. And then on top of that, now all of these things kind of fell into my lap, and I had to navigate how I was going to do that. And it took me some time. But, you know, rather rapidly, I picked it up. But I think any guy with given the opportunity to show their worth and show what they can do, especially when your biggest critics are your family and your biggest supporters are your family. But if given the opportunity to show them what you can do, you find a way to do it. And you find a way to do it quickly.
So you stepped up and took a lot of responsibility, even though it was stressful, it sounds
yep.
like.
Yep.
How else did you change?
I changed into a more understanding and loving person.
You did?
Yeah.
Tell me about that.
When we were going through our difficult times, I was angry all the time. I would be angry at her. I'd be angry at the kids. I'd be angry at the toaster. I mean, it was just a perpetual circle and cycle of anger and frustration. And so I think what has changed me is that I'm no longer that person. I was no longer living for the moment. Now I live for the future. What's going to happen in the future? How we're going to grow as a family, how my wife and I are going to become even stronger. Those are the things that really have changed me. I've become, like I mentioned earlier, I've become in love with my wife again. I always loved her and I was in love with her at once, but truthfully, there was a part in our lives where we kind of fell out of love with each other. And it was mutual. It wasn't just me. That needs to be clear. But I have absolutely fallen back in love with her. And I think that this has been something that's been an absolute blessing in our lives.
And so you are more future oriented now. You're planning ahead. You have a vision you want to fulfill on for your family, it sounds like. Tell me about your vision for your family.
You know, the vision for our family is to spend as much time together, because I, at 11 years old, I see my son, and it seems like yesterday he was just born. And I'm not going to lie, I get a little teary when I drop him off at school. And I think to myself, I have 7 more years until he's gone. And, you know, having my wife, you know, transition from her very high demanding. I think that's the other thing that I kind of left out, was that during that time when we were having issues, my wife was also a very high powered executive within a CBS television. There's no secret in that. And she ran sales teams across the country, and she was a very powerful person. That bled over into our relationship. You know, one of the things I also wanted to mention was when we would argue, or when we would talk, or when I was vulnerable to my wife at that time, which was rare, I would instantly get the manager. I wouldn't get the loving wife. I would get, well, you need to do this, this, and this. And you need to do this, this, and this in a certain time frame. And I remember just being like, well, that's not what I'm looking for. I just need to bounce. I just need a soundboard. I need someone to give me a hug. I mean, it sounds, you know, I mean, it, you know, it doesn't sound masculine, but I don't really care about that. But I really just needed a hug and a kiss and just say, hey, it's going to be okay. And I never got that. And I think any guy would also be lying if they said that's not what they need. Because I know that's what I need. Sometimes you just need your wife to wrap their arms around you and just tell you they'll love you and give you a kiss, and that's it.
Yeah, or you're smart and you're going to figure this out. And
yeah, exactly. Compliments.
I trust you. Yeah, yeah.
Compliments go a long way.
This reflection of your of the strength they see in you. Yeah. Yeah. And a hug and a kiss. Absolutely. I love that.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you would get the manager, and then it wasn't what you needed.
No.
And then how would you react from there?
Oh, I would just point blank tell her, you know, I'm not your employee. I don't work for you. Don't boss me around. You know, I'm trying to be vulnerable, and I don't like it. And I'm sick of it. So then what happens? I'm no longer vulnerable.
That's right.
I no longer go to her, you know, with things that normal people would go to their spouses about.
That's right.
Then it just becomes this walled off, you know, screw you. I'm not going to tell you what's going on in my life. You're not going to tell me. So we just we were roommates. That's what we were. And roommates without the benefit of sex.
Benefits. Yeah, of sex. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that wasn't happening either.
Well, if it was, it was very dull. I mean, I don't know how else to put it. Yeah. And it was, clinical, if you will. It was just an operation. It didn't really mean much. And she was very quick at that time. And used it candidly as a weapon against me. You know, if you don't do this, we're not going to do this. And you have to earn it. And I just remember being like, this is not what I signed up for.
No, definitely not. It definitely sounds, it sounds very difficult and painful and long, like it would make time expand, right? To be in this situation.
Well, and lonely to boot.
And lonely. And I love the part about how sentimental you are dropping your son off at school and realizing you have just the given time and you want to make the most of it. And I'm wondering how everything's impacted those two little people you're raising.
I can give you a perfect example. Yesterday, my wife made an agreement with our boys that they were going to go on a hike. And I, you know, I think she's mentioned we live in out west and up in the mountains. And they got in the car and both of them said, we don't want to go. We want to get in the, you know, we want to go do iPads or whatever. And my wife was like, listen, you made the agreement. You're going to stick to the agreement. You have to trust me. They got out. Of course, they did a 5-mile hike. The boys had the greatest time on earth. And my youngest pulled my wife aside and said, Mom, you're absolutely right. I should have trusted you. I know to trust you. You never let me down, and I will do what, you know, I'll follow you. And I think that is the biggest and best example I can give you of how it has transformed our kids. They are no longer aggressive towards each other, towards, well, I take that back. They're severely aggressive towards each other.
They're little boy siblings. That's right.
Okay. I guess what I mean by that is they don't attack each other verbally. They don't attack us verbally. You know, we've kind of become this cohesive unit of love and respect. And that is really how it's changed them, I believe.
Wow. I mean, that has to melt you as a parent to have your kids say, Mom, you were right. I should have trusted you. This is from a 9-year-old. Is that right?
He's a pretty astute child.
I guess so. Yeah. Yeah.
You know, I think the other thing is, you know, when I grew up, my mom and dad were and are still deeply in love. And I remember on many occasions, Thursday nights, Friday nights, Saturdays, they would turn music on and dance with each other. They would hug each other, kiss each other. Our family was very, very physical. You know, we hug and kiss, and we're that way. And since this transition, my wife and I have become that way. And I think what impacts little boys is to see mom and dad love each other is what I believe is going to carry them into the future to where their spouse, whatever they decide to do, whichever direction they go in, I guess, man or woman, they're going to learn that. And that's something that they learn and move forward with. You can't teach compassion. It's just got to be a part of you, and it's got to be something that you grow up with. And I think that is the other goal that I have, is to show my sons that when you get married, you have to love your wife, and that hopefully, knock on wood, that rubs off. And I think it has, because our boys are extremely affectionate, hugs and kisses every morning, hugs and kisses every night. And so I'm really hoping that rubs off.
Oh my gosh. You must feel so proud to be that role model, like you grew up with, of what a loving relationship looks like, that there's dancing on Thursday, Fridays, and Saturdays, and there's hugs and kisses throughout the day. That must feel so good.
It's fantastic. You know, I think it's a little different for my wife, because she didn't have that. That wasn't her upbringing, from what I understand. You know, I know her family very, very well. They are wonderful, kind, gentle people, but they are not as affectionate and as compassionate as my family is. And that's not saying it's good or bad, but what it's saying is, one of the reasons why I give her even more credit in the world is because that is not something she grew up with.
That's right. She didn't have that training. That wasn't part of her upbringing.
That's right. So that's, I give, you know, again, I give her even more credit for that.
Yeah, absolutely. And so, and I really just hear you're thinking more about how you're showing up as a role model for those kids. It sounds like it almost sounds like you didn't have the bandwidth to even give that consideration, because there was so much, there was like a survival mode really kind of going on.
Yep.
Before. So how else has that impacted you? What other things are you doing differently as a role model for those boys now?
I think mostly it's showing them, you know, I mean, we've done everything from, now I, you know, my responsibility is I do homework with the kids. I'm fortunate enough to where I built an office here on our property and a barn here on our property, so I have a place to go to. And now subsequently the boys have a place to go to that's quiet, relaxing, and it's a work environment. So we do homework together every night. And the reward is we get to play a little Xbox together tonight. So that's not a bad thing. And that's really kind of, you know, that is one example of how I'm trying to influence them, is to show them, look, hard work, whether it's homework or whether it's actual work, is a blessing. It's not something you should dread. It's something that you should embrace. And, you know, learning now how to do homework is going to teach you in the future, not only how to do homework, but it's going to teach you how to be a, you know, a productive person. You know, I think just ultimately it's spending time as a family together. You know, my wife included, not just me and the boys, but it's all four of us. So that's kind of how I think, you know, things have changed.
I love that. I also heard, so you can confirm these rumors, that you have gone on a health kick recently.
I have.
Tell us about that.
So I'm not ashamed to say that I'm a recovering alcoholic. I am 16 months and 10 days sober.
Wow. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Huge.
And I, you know, having also said that, you know, realizing I need to make a huge change in my life from a health factor in terms of losing weight. And, you know, I mean, listen, I coach both of my sons and their football and baseball, and I got to the point where I just couldn't run with them anymore. And I thought, this is crazy. I mean, I might be 45, but I can beat a 10-year-old in a race, right? I should be able to. So I, you know, I started this health kick. You know, I played college football, and we ride horses, and I've had two back surgeries. I've had two knee surgeries. And last year I broke my back because I was thrown off my horse. So, you know, those are also factors to lose weight, to be better. You know, I should say with the drinking, it is certainly not anyone's fault but my own. But during that time period when my wife and I were in this hell, alcohol was my escape. And it was something that was very easy for me to do. Because the more she nagged, the more she griped, the more I drank, and the more it kind of dulled everything. So it's certainly not her fault, but it was a contributed to those things. Alcohol was my way of coping and dulling all of the criticisms and disrespect. It's not my wife's fault. It's my fault, but there was certainly that was a contributor. And I am very proud to say that after my wife went through this transition through your program, it turned my entire mindset around. And this goes back to living for the future. Whereas before, I wasn't living for the future. I was living day to day and thinking, now this is just going to implode and I don't know what's going to happen, but, you know, I'm going down this weird rabbit hole. But, you know, it took me a little time, but then I just realized, hey, I can be vulnerable with my wife, and not only will she not criticize, but she's going to support me now. And that was very difficult for me, incredibly difficult, to come out to her and say, hey, listen, I have a problem and I need your help. And not only was she supportive, but she has been supportive every day. She quit drinking herself. And it's that love and respect that I get from her that keeps me sober and that keeps me moving forward. And I never thought that I would be this fulfilled, and I truly never thought that I would be this healthy again. But I am. And I, you know, it really is because she and I are a unit. And if I didn't have her, I would be in a ditch somewhere. And I absolutely say that without any hesitation.
Wow. That's astounding. I'm so impressed. So would you say that she had tried to get you to stop drinking previously? Was that part of the...
Oh sure. And okay. I think the more she pushed me, the more I drank. The more she would criticize me, the more she would tell me, you have a drinking problem, or you have an anger issue, you have a mental issue. I mean, it got to the point where she was blaming me for everything. And every time she would say, you do this, you do that, I would do the opposite.
Yes. Yes.
You know, don't eat so much. Oh, okay. Well, I'm going to go get a double cheeseburger. Don't drink so much. Oh, well, here, I tell you what, I'm going to have a bottle of wine and a six pack tonight.
Yeah. So she had her foot on the accelerator when she thought she was putting it on the brake, but it was quite the opposite.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay. And you've lost some weight as well as getting sober. Is that right?
Lost almost 80 pounds.
80 pounds.
Yeah.
Okay. 16 months and 10 days sober and 80 pound weight loss. And this is all, you attribute all of this to the great connection you have with your wife.
Without a shadow of a doubt. I mean, and I think what it ultimately is that her change has impacted not only me, but all of us to something that has let me love myself again. Not just me loving her again, but I have this insatiable appetite to love myself. And I fully contributed to our close connection now. And you know, again, it has everything to do with me falling back in love with her.
Wow. I am so impressed. I mean, those are really impressive changes that you made. And it's just so helpful to hear you describe the way your wife used her influence instead of maybe control and criticism, and got such an incredibly different response from you. And I love this insatiable self-love you're describing. How's your confidence now?
Colossal. It's huge. You know, and I think for any women or men who are going to listen to this, I think the other thing that we haven't touched on, and maybe you were planning on, but not only have I fallen back in love with my wife, but our intimacy and our love life has never been better, ever. And I think that for any guy to have not only routine intimacy with your wife, but new and creative intimacy with your wife, wow, also gives you a huge boost in confidence. And I've noticed that we talked about vulnerability, but my wife's ability to be vulnerable with me in the bedroom gives me the confidence to be vulnerable with her, not just in the bedroom, but outside of that and in all aspects. So whatever you've done, keep it up, because this is a part that I absolutely love. And I think, again, from a man's perspective, sex is like water. Sex is like food. It has to happen. And the more you have, the more you love, the more you're willing to do things, the more, at least from my perspective, I don't know how, if I'm going too deep into this or being divulging too much, but you know, for me, and I think for any guy, you know, sex is something that's, you know, it's as necessary as breathing.
Wow. No, I love that you went into that. I don't think I would have been brave enough to ask about it directly. So thank you for volunteering, because sure, this is a big part. And it's something we do talk a lot about on our campus, because it's such an important part of a marriage, right? This is the only relationship. It's what distinguishes it from every other relationship you have. You hug your kids and you share things with your sister or whatever, but sex is the one thing that really differentiates this relationship. That's what makes it a romance. And so I love that you brought that forth, and what a difference that's made for you. And it sounds like your confidence, that's part of your inner strength, is knowing you have this great sex life, better than ever sex life with your wife.
Yeah. I mean, better than before we got married, better than when we first met.
Tell me about that. Why is it better than that?
You know, I think it's better because we know each other now. We love each other, respect each other, and, you know, have that ability to be vulnerable and intimate in a way that we never could before. You know, we were also younger and we partied a lot, and I think it takes some time. I remember when I proposed to my wife, my father-in-law said, not until you're 30, because guys are absolute idiots until they're 30. And I would say it even probably is a little bit longer than 30.
It's 35
right.
Well, thanks, father-in-law. But yeah, okay. But you kind of agree with him now that you're 45.
The compassion thing I was talking about. But now it's better than ever because of all of those other elements that we just didn't have before.
Wow. Impressive. Amazing. And all right. So tell me what it's like at your house now.
In what respect?
I mean, I don't know. Just I'm dropping into your house and I'm just kind of hanging out with you guys one evening on a weeknight or something. What's going on? What's it like?
Well, if it's Monday night, we're watching football together.
Okay.
It's Thursday night, like tonight, because we're huge Broncos fans and they play Cleveland tonight. So
okay,
we will likely be watching that. But, you know, we eat together. So if you were to come over, we'd probably all have dinner together. There's, you know, usually board games that happen. Last night, my sons and I played Connect Four for 2 hours. So that was fun. And then homework. If you want to come over and help with homework, you're always welcome. I'd love that.
I'll consider it. Yeah.
Believe it or not, math nowadays is very difficult.
I understand. If they need help with girl math, I could help with that. So you weren't doing the homework before. Is that right?
Mm-mm.
You weren't. This is a new thing.
And this is something that my wife came to me and said, I would love your help with homework. And I said, no problem. In fact, I will one up you and I will have the boys come down to the office where it's quiet and it's a work environment. We'll sit down, we'll do our homework together. I'll work at the same time they're doing their homework. If they need help, we can, because before it was, we would wait until Sunday night. And then it was an absolute disaster. And this is now, this wasn't before, this is now, to where everyone's running around like chickens with their heads cut off. You got to do this, you got to do that. Oh my God, we got homework, we got 10 pages of math, we got 4 hours of reading that we have to cram into 2 hours. And so we talked about it. We had a good discussion and she said, I need your help. And so we've changed everything. Now we do homework every single night. We do it in my office. And then their reward for them is just as big of a reward for me because we sit down and it sounds ridiculous, but we get to play video games together. And that's what boys like. And truthfully, that's what I like. So
yeah.
Spending a little time together doing that has been a blessing.
I mean, I love it. It actually sounds like a lot of fun. It sounds very functional. I guess it's one of the words that comes to mind, I get a sense of security, like there's a routine and it sounds peaceful. Like everyone knows what's expected.
Well, I think it kind of goes back to the other thing, which was after she met you and did all this, it was the respect and the allowing me to make a mistake and allowing me to broaden my horizons. And we have carried that over to our boys to where it's now we say, hey, look, the responsibility is on you. You know, we would love it if you would do this. It's your decision. But at the end of the day, you know, these are your responsibilities. And they have embraced that. And they have said, you know, and they take it upon themselves now to do their homework. And I think it's because we've empowered them. My wife's empowerment of me has allowed the both of us to empower our boys to be more independent.
So you're an empowered husband.
I think so.
Okay. I love it. Cause we talk about empowering wives here. And what I hear is that her becoming empowered you also, and now has empowered both of your boys. And I love that. How important is it to you, Matthew, that your wife is happy?
Incredibly important. I ask her often, are you happy? And when she says yes, it makes me happy because it means I'm doing something right. I think before, if I'd asked her if she was happy, she'd say, no, I'm not happy. But now, you know, when I ask her, she says she is, and I ask her often.
You probably weren't asking her before.
Nah, I didn't really care.
Yeah, because but now, well, because you knew the answer. You were saying she probably would have said no. So no
or she would have said yes and then rolled her eyes, you know.
Okay. Yeah. So either way, it would have been a painful answer because it's incredibly important to you.
Right.
And yeah. So, what tips do you have since you've been on the husband side of this? What tips do you have for women who are currently struggling in their marriage? What should they do?
Oh boy. That's a big question.
It's a loaded question. Yeah.
It's a loaded question.
I'm giving you zingers. I think you're out for it.
That's fine. I can feel these. You know, I think the biggest tip would be to back off, to slow down. And if you could make just one adjustment, that would be relinquishing some of the control. And I'm not saying that all marriages are like this. I'm not saying that this happens to be a systemic marriage issue with women, because I don't know that. I can only speak for myself.
That's
but
right.
I think there's likely some level of control that has emasculated a husband and that has probably put them in a position that I was in, which is, screw it. You know, I'm not gonna, if you're not gonna respect me, I'm certainly not gonna respect you. So I think that if there was the beginning and what you should likely start at would be try as tough as it might be to show some respect and relinquish control. And even if that's a rapid thing or a slow thing, I can guarantee your husband is going to react to that in a positive way, because the more love, respect, and you know, empowerment, you use that word, the more men respond.
Mm. And, you know, it just occurred to me too, your wife was relinquishing that control and showing that respect. And it sounds like you were still drinking at that time.
I was.
And you had kind of given up hope. So you didn't really care. So she was showing this respect and giving you this trust kind of in the face of some things that people could have said, well, this isn't going to work because look, he's drinking and he doesn't care.
Right. Right.
So that was.
Yeah. I mean, I think the other thing that I would mention to any woman who's having an issue in their marriage is don't give up. Continue with it. You know, you can't do it for 2 weeks and think that everything's going to change. If you do it for 2 weeks, I will tell you this, and I firmly believe this, because one of the reasons why I kept drinking, one of the reasons why I was very defensive and angry continuously was because I was waiting for the other shoe to drop. I thought, there's no freaking way this is going to last. This is some mind trick. This is her trying to manipulate me in some weird way. And it was just kind of a persistence on my wife's part. And then it just snowballed into, okay, this is real. This is not a joke. This is not a mind trick. This is real life. And so the suggestion that I would make is don't give up. 2 weeks isn't going to cut it. 4 weeks isn't going to cut it. Hell, 6 months might not cut it. But if you continue down that path of respect, love, and compassion, I can guarantee it will change your entire marriage.
Wow. And so as long as we're talking about timelines, because this does come up a lot, because like you mentioned, you had been looking for an apartment at one point in your marriage. And sometimes, you know, a wife is in that situation where he's kind of thinking, okay, she's going to fall. I better, get out of here before I get kicked out of here.
Right.
So let's talk about, so you did mention you noticed a difference, a pretty dramatic difference right away, but you didn't trust it, right? Which is, right. I think, understandable. And then, but how long would you say, you say 6 months might not cut it, but where were you guys at 6 months in? Like how had that changed things?
Yeah. I mean, I think it was around the 6 month mark for me to where it was real. It was no longer just a, hey, I'm going to change for a while. I could see in my wife that this was a permanent change, because not only did she embrace the learnings from you and your outfit, she embraced it to the point where she knew this was something that she was meant to do. And, you know, I think you can, in order to teach it, you have to live it. And that is where she was, and she was fully committed. And I saw that and I respected it. And I thought, this is our new life and I'm down and I am in 100%.
You are. You're in 100%.
Yeah.
No question.
100%.
Wow. Was there anything about it that bugged you that you think, well, there's just one piece that just doesn't sit right with me or.
Yeah. And I don't mean to insult anyone, but from my perspective, you know, I always thought in the back of my head, you know, this is just a gimmicky. This is not something that I, you know, because no man would ever subscribe to something like this, you know, somebody telling you how to, you know, how to manage a relationship, you know, unless you're giving me statistics on John Elway's, fourth game in the 1988 Super Bowl, I don't really want to hear about it. And it wasn't 88, it was 90 and 91.
Just to be clear.
But, you know, it's, you know, so I thought it was, you know, it was a kind of a mind ploy. It was reverse psychology. And it was this weird, that was my pet peeve with it. But then again, as things grew, and as we got into that 6 month mark, I thought, you know, it's not a mind manipulation. It is a change of life. It is a change of lifestyle. It is a change of everything. And then I can honestly say there's nothing that I don't, you know, I have no picadillies with it. I don't have anything that's negative to say about it now.
Oh, cool. I appreciate that. Thanks so much. You've been so forthcoming and just honest with us. And this is just so valuable. This is just, you're dreamy. So thank you so much for all this candid stuff. And I want to now turn to some anonymous questions from students.
Oh boy.
I know. I mean, this could be the scary part, right? But so one of the questions is, what's the kindest, most inspiring thing that your wife has said to you?
I am looking at a note that she left on my desk the other day, out of the blue. And it says, "You are so loved and so admired, and you are my hero, and you are amazing with our kids. Please don't ever forget that."
Oh, fantastic.
So it was just last week. And, yeah.
So that melted you. It melted me just hearing you read that.
I mean, it really brings tears to my eyes because it's not what we were used to.
No, oh, and it's so important. It's so important that you get to hear that and yeah. She gets to say it and believe it, right? You know, she's
right.
Authentic. Yeah.
Yeah. And it's stuff like that that's just out of the blue that, you know, I came down to work one morning and that note was just sitting right on my desk. And I just, it's those little things that for me just make me fall in love with her again all over because I know I'm loved.
Yeah. Yeah. A lot of emotional safety there in your partnership.
Yeah.
All right. So next question is, if there has been a break in sex, how did it come back?
Yeah, so that's a really good question. And I would say that the ownership of that is on you. And by you, I mean, I'm assuming that's a female who's asking.
The wife, yes.
Because you are the gatekeeper. You're the one that can dictate whether or not sex is going to happen. You can dictate on whether or not sex is going to be good. And you can dictate when and where and how. I think that the best way to break that mold of a hiatus from sex, or at least a hiatus from passionate good sex, is to dig deep, try to be vulnerable, and understand that your husband, if you are vulnerable, will not only be receptive to that, but be vulnerable in return and understand your vulnerability, and it will change your life. I guarantee it.
Hmm. So could you give us an example of what you mean by being vulnerable when it comes to sex?
Yeah, I think what I mean by that, there's a couple of things I mean by that. I think, you know, because before, sex was just an activity. It wasn't an event. It was just something that had to be done. I think my wife felt like it had to be done just because I wanted it, not because it was something she was necessarily into.
So it was a chore.
It was a chore, absolutely. And I think what I mean by vulnerability is having the openness to have more frequent sex, to keep in mind and remember that it is something that men need, and that it can be, while it might not be now, it can be extremely fun.
Yeah. Yeah. So kind of being open to her own pleasure in this event and not,
Exactly. And I think the other thing is there are a lot of women out there, although I can't speak for all, that are afraid to explore. And what I mean by vulnerability is releasing that control of fear of exploring. I mean, you know, I'm just going to be, I don't know how open you want me to be, but I feel like I probably need to be for people who are listening. You know, I mean, there are many things you can do. And I think, you know, if you've never, you know, used any sort of aid or toy or anything like that, that is fun. That is something that you can be like, wow, okay, she's into that. So, wow, this is awesome. Like, maybe I can be into that. Maybe we can explore new things. And you know, and I think those other tools, if you will, can also help women climax easier, which helps them because it can be a whole new experience for women versus men. I mean, let's just be honest, it doesn't take us long. So, you know, there's always that goes along with that. So that's what I mean by vulnerability to have more frequent sex and be open to it. And also explore each other more.
Yeah. And like you said, relinquish control, like choosing your faith instead of your fear, even in the bedroom, it sounds like. Just like, let's just see what's going to happen. Let's experiment. Let's explore. Yeah.
Let's make it an event.
I love that answer. All right. So what makes you feel disrespected?
I think what makes me feel disrespected would be any time there is a question in my ability to either complete a task or manage a situation. You know, I mean, it still happens, right? I mean, but it's mitigated to the point where it doesn't get either one of us, we're caboodled. We don't get upset with each other. You know, it's little things like as we're walking out the door to go football practice, you know, she'll say, do you have his cup? Do you have his water bottle? Do you have his mouth guard? Do you have these things? And I'm like, I'm the head coach. I have all that stuff. You know, don't tell me I don't have it. You know, of course it's my job to have it. Those are the things that I don't necessarily know they're disrespectful. It's nitpicky, and it's just kind of, and it's certainly not her reverting back to an old habit. It's just, that's how moms are.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. No, I appreciate this. And no marriage is perfect, right? And no wife is perfectly respectful. Not me, not anybody, right? I'll send you a postcard if that ever happens, but I still end up apologizing for being disrespectful. And so it's fair. And I love how specific this example is, just her checking in on, did you bring the basic equipment that, you know, every football coach or every football dad needs to bring, is if it rubs you wrong, basically, even though it is, I think from a female perspective, it just feels like, well, I'm just checking. I'm just making sure. And it's just helpful to hear that the way that lands on male ears is, it's not helpful. It's actually, it's controlling and disrespectful. Right. So,
The other example would be anytime we're driving and I'm driving and I grew up in this city and I grew up, I mean, literally know every street corner, like the back of my hand. And if she's using Waze or Google Maps, she just looks at that and goes, you have to turn left here. And I'm like, no, I don't have to turn left here. I know exactly where I'm going. And then we get into a little bit of an argument of, but you don't know what this knows, so you don't know how fast it's going to be. And that's when I get a little, you know, I mean, they're stupid things, right? But you know, over time, and, you know, if you hear them enough, they become disrespectful and annoying.
No, these are great examples, because this is where life is happening. This is where your relationship is happening in all these little moments, right? The time she says, I need help with the homework, or the time she says, you know, GPS says you got to turn left, right? All those little moments add up to the sum of our relationships and how we're enjoying them and how safe and confident we're feeling, how loved, how heard and seen and known, which is something we all need. And you are just an amazing example of somebody who really rose to the occasion as your wife made these changes, some of them simple but profound changes that had you become, it sounds like, your best self. And then therefore create this wonderful family that you've described, not perfect family, but it sounds pretty fantastic. It sounds pretty dreamy to, you know, play Connect Four and do that homework and have the video games with your son and the hikes and the great sex that's going on at your house. So I just want to congratulate you and thank you for bringing this inspiring, true, real life story to us on this podcast. We don't usually get to see the inside of marriages, but you've really given us a glimpse of that from your perspective. It's just priceless.
Yeah, I do greatly appreciate it. And I have to give thanks to you. Because without you, this it wouldn't be this way.
Well, thank you so much. That's very encouraging to hear, and I appreciate it. And I too, as you said, I also want to give a lot of credit to your wife, who's done an incredible job, really fixing her family, making her marriage last and thrive.
Without question. And I think for any one of your listeners too, it will absolutely change your life, because it's, you know, you have the power to change it all.
Yeah. 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 You really are a great illustration of that, how your wife used her power wisely, and now you're using your power so wisely as well. And it's fired. I'm so inspired.
Well, great. Thank you so much. I really appreciate this time. It's been really nice to get to know you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. If you'd like to be my guest on the Empowered Wife podcast and share about how you fixed a struggling relationship using the 6 intimacy skills, I would love to interview you. Just go to lauradoyle.org/podcast-guest to let me know that you are willing to make a big contribution to ending world divorce by telling your relationship story. I look forward to meeting you. That's lauradoyle.org/podcast-guest. Listen and subscribe to the Empowered Wife podcast. Next week, the Worst Relationship Advice of the Week award will be returning in all its nauseating splendor. The competition is intense. In the meantime, I hope you're having lots of fun. Today's fun fact is that I had to apologize for being disrespectful to my husband this morning for saying, no, 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 after he told me he paid something that I happen to know was already paid. If I ever get perfect with these 6 intimacy skills, I'll be sure to send you a postcard.